Blade Runner, the final cut, is directed by Ridley Scott and it stars Harrison Ford, Rutger Hauer, and Sean Young. So Blade Runner won by a pretty fair margin in the last poll. The only two films that came close were I Saw the Devil and The Wailing, which are two films that I'm also going to be reviewing, but I'm going to be reviewing them next week. I just got too caught up with shooting my short film. I didn't have the time to watch them, but be on the lookout for those reviews next week. And if you've been really enjoying these subscriber choice poll reviews, please give this video a like along with the other poll reviews that I've done this far. So this might come as a huge surprise to a lot of people, but I have never actually seen the original Blade Runner. I know, it's like cinema blasphemy to even admit that. To be this far into my life and this deep into film and to still not have seen Blade Runner, I know, it's like send me straight to the guillotine. But it's just one of those things to where a classic film just, you just never get around to it, and you just never take the time to watch it. But I have seen Denis Villeneuve's sequel, Blade Runner 2049, which is a film that I absolutely loved, and apparently I didn't have to watch the original Blade Runner for me to really respect and appreciate that film. I really want to go back and watch Blade Runner 2049, because even though I already loved it, I feel like I might appreciate and love it even more, which is a huge statement. But I think that there's going to be things about it that I might appreciate on a more higher level. But either way, I did finally watch Blade Runner, but I watched the final cut. And the reason why I watched the final cut is because most people that I talk to that are fans of Blade Runner, and just most film lovers in general, tell me that the final cut is the best version of the film. It's apparently Ridley Scott's actual vision of the film where he had full control over. And what I hear is the main difference between the final cut and the theatrical version is that the theatrical version contains this kind of voice-over narration throughout the film. And usually, like, I'm not a big fan of that, especially if it's in a big-budget Hollywood movie. Because when it's from a blockbuster, it has a higher chance of being there for the sole purpose of making sure that the audience fully understands a lot of the information that's going on in the story and what's going on in certain situations. And that to me can come off just really lazy and incredibly annoying. And that's why I went with watching the final cut. And now that I've actually seen the film, first off, let me say what I think is this film's biggest achievement. I think that the aesthetic direction to this film, as far as the cinematography goes, as far as the score goes, as far as the sound design goes, as far as the art direction and the production design and the set decoration and just the lighting as well, I just feel like all the aesthetics and how all of it's directed and put together is just on a whole other level of filmmaking. I mean, every scene and every shot of this feels so incredibly meticulous and delicate, and it's just so effective when it comes to world building. And you can tell that the people that were really behind this film and were really making this film truly cared about the art of filmmaking and really wanted to give it their all in terms of giving audiences an actual world that they can get immersed in. And it was really, really impressive, and I enjoyed essentially every frame of the aesthetics in this film because they are absolutely mind-blowing. And when I was watching this film, I was like, I'm like 100% sure that this film at least won for special effects and for set decoration. And I was wrong. Apparently, Gandhi won for production design and art direction, and E.T. won for best special effects. You know, I guess I can see E.T. winning. I personally just hugely disagree with that, but I guess I can see why that would happen. But Gandhi winning best set decoration and art direction over Blade Runner, I mean, that just makes absolutely no sense to me. And apparently Gandhi won a shitload of awards that year. And, you know, Gandhi's a film that, like, nobody really talks about. Like, honestly, no one ever comes up to me and fucking says, oh, Gandhi's such a great film, you gotta watch it. Like, I've seen Gandhi, too, like, back when I was in high school, and, I mean, whatever. Like, I just feel like if I want to watch and learn something about Gandhi, I can just watch a documentary. I don't fucking need to watch an overhyped Oscar bait type film. And just huge shame on the Academy for doing some shit like that. But yeah, the aesthetics in this film are just absolutely stunning. I love the way the score is used throughout this film too, because the way that the scores accompany certain scenes really elevates the situation that's actually occurring on screen. And, you know, there's a handful of scenes in here where I could easily say was enhanced by the way the sound and the score was used. And those were some of my favorite sequences in the film, was when the score was used just right with certain scenes. And I just really appreciated that aspect of this film. But one other thing about this film that I really didn't see coming and I really, really appreciated and was extremely impressed by was the villain character in this. Because the villain character that's played by Rutger Hauer, like, it's kind of unfair to even call him a villain because his motivation throughout the film seems completely warranted. And just how the ending in the third act unfolds, between the conflict, between him and Harrison Ford, it just adds layers of nuance and complexity to a villain character that most blockbusters today, like, wouldn't even try to do. And it actually makes you question, like, who is actually the bad guy versus who's the good guy. And I just love films that care to put enough effort into having these multidimensional characters, you know, rather than having these one-sided, one-dimensional type characters that are just kind of cardboard cutouts of a villain or a hero. And this film has complexity with both characters, with both Harrison Ford's character and the villain character. And there's a monologue that happens in the end. Well, I guess it's not like a monologue, but the villain has his own little spiel at the end of the film, and I thought, like, it was beautifully said and beautifully done, and overall, like, again, the way that this third act unfolded and the way that this film presented its villain character, I thought was really nuanced and really insightful overall. And another really neat aspect about this film is that, yeah, it's like a dystopian sci-fi and has, like, a little bit of that cyberpunk kind of thing, but what's really cool about it is that it also adds this kind of crime noir style to it. Not only like with how some of the story and characters are portrayed, but definitely with the score, because there's this like saxophone type score that is, it's not a thing that happens like all the time throughout the film, but it happens in certain moments and certain spurts. And I just think that the way it used for certain scenes was just really interesting because it's definitely a genre-blending type film, and that wasn't really something that I was prepared for going into it. And I was just pleasantly surprised with how unique this film was in terms of genre, and that was something that was really interesting as I was watching the film. But I guess to get into a few criticisms that I do have with the film, because in my opinion, I don't think that this is a perfect film. I don't think that this is like a 10 out of 10 masterpiece. And the only reason why I say that is because mainly two things. The first one being that even though that this is Ridley Scott's ultimate vision, some of the dialogue was just kind of hard to get through and was a little annoying when I was watching it. And I do understand that this was a huge film. This is a mainstream film, blockbuster type film that was really made to cater to a huge audience. And I get that they're really trying to make sure that, you know, the audience understands what's happening with certain characters and what's going on in the story. But there are moments that, like, I just can't ignore where characters are just saying too much to the audience. And you can tell that there's dialogue there that is really only there to make sure the audience understands something.
Memories. You're talking about memories.
I guess you're through, huh?
And unfortunately, when those things would happen in the film, it would slightly take me out of it for a second. And, you know, the only reason why that is because a lot of that stuff was either conveyed visually or was conveyed with even more unique dialogue that didn't just spell it out, but they kind of had to, like, go the extra mile and make sure that the audience understood. And that's just really bothersome to me because I get it for a huge audience, but it still bothers me. It really does, because even with Blade Runner 2049, like, that was a film that was for a huge audience. But there wasn't as much of that kind of awkward dialogue that just felt forced in order to make the audience understand. And, you know, I just wish this film maybe had less of that. And maybe I would have enjoyed those aspects of the film in terms of writing a little bit more than I did. But apparently with the theatrical version, it's just like haywire with it. Apparently with the theatrical version, it just like the voiceover narration is just like relentless. And it just makes sure the audience understands a lot of stuff. I don't know because I've never seen it. Maybe those who are watching this who have seen the theatrical version can tell me whether or not the voiceover narration, you know, just felt forced and just felt like the producers wanted to make sure that everybody understood what was going on. That'd be really cool to get some insight on that. So please let me know in the comment section. But overall, I'm glad I watched the final cut because obviously I had some criticisms with those aspects of the film, but I just feel like it would have just been just incredibly heightened to a whole other level if I watched the theatrical version. But one other thing about this film that also just didn't work for me overall was the big romantic scene in this film. I'm not saying that the romance in this film was completely flat or that I didn't like it, but there's this big, like, romantic scene in the film between Harrison Ford and Sean Young's character. And I'm sorry, just like the way that the saxophone was used and the way that the characters were interacting with each other and the way that it was directed, it just didn't work for me. Like, it felt a little bit cheesy. It felt a little bit forced, and it was weird. Like, I felt like I was watching some, like, dramatic soap opera sequence, and that was also one of the sequences in this film that kind of took me out for a little bit. And, you know, that was something that I really didn't expect, because I thought that, first of all, I didn't expect there to be that much romance in this film. There's not a lot of it, but I didn't expect it to be, like, you know, a prolonged romantic sequence. But when it occurred, I just felt like the execution of it bothered me, and I wasn't really engaged in that part, and it took me out a little bit. But those are really the only criticisms that I have of the film. Overall, I still think that this is a pretty incredible piece of filmmaking that is an achievement in its own right. I mean, again, the production design and the aesthetic direction and is what it was able to achieve for its time. I mean, it's quite stunning, and there are sequences in this film that I found absolutely stunning. And, you know, the overall direction is on point. The villain character is nuanced and complex, and I love that. Even the main character, it's not just cardboard cutout bullshit. The story is quite interesting. Oh, and one thing that I haven't mentioned yet, I know it's kind of scattered, but let me just say this really quick. This film, in terms of how it compares to Blade Runner 2049, I found that there was a similarity between how they both structured their films, because in both films, they have these long sequences. Like, I feel like these films, both of them, are done in these long sequences, and they don't do a lot of cross-cutting between certain events, which is rather strange, because usually when you watch mainstream-type films, you know, they do a lot of cross-cutting between events to make sure that the audience, you know, feels like they're understanding the timeline between these events, and that way they don't forget that certain established events are occurring at the same time. Both Blade Runner and Blade Runner 2049 have this approach of just having these really prolonged sequences of events and then eventually getting back to certain sequences. And, you know, I don't know if it is 100% effective, but I highly appreciate the structural approach to it, because it's certainly something that you don't really get with most mainstream films, or really most films in general, because, you know, that's just kind of the formulaic thing to do. And I do appreciate its effort into not, you know, catering to that kind of conventional style of filmmaking. And like I said, this film overall achieves a lot. I really, really enjoyed it for the most part. There's just certain things about it that, you know, I'd be lying if I said didn't bug me, because they certainly did, and they were taking me out a little bit. But overall, this film has a lot to love. The aesthetics are pitch perfect. The cinematography is out of this world. The production design is out of this world. The vast majority of the score is utilized in an incredible way. And I'm really, really glad that I finally got to watch this film, because honestly, it really didn't disappoint. So I'm going to give Blade Runner, the final cut, an 8.5 out of 10. This is definitely a film that I'm going to be buying on Blu-ray soon. I just have to add it to my collection, because it really is a film that's worth buying and worth re-watching throughout your lifetime. And like I said, after watching this film, it really made me want to go back and watch Blade Runner 2049. So I'm really, really excited to eventually re-watch that soon. And for those who don't know, I did come out with a Good Time character analysis. It's basically just me making the case that Connie does not love his brother in the film. And if you haven't checked it out, please check that out already. And if you really enjoy what I had to say about Blade Runner, please give this video a thumbs up and share it amongst your friends. And don't forget to subscribe to the channel to be updated on more film-related content.